well, yeah. It, whenever I get an email for the next session that I'll go in for, the subject line is always Titan slash Muppet Babies, and I'm like, yes.
Recording those are so funny for me because literally it's like, the script is like half reactions of me eating, and then all of my dialogue is about the food that I want to eat or am eating. So basically, that's all that Sasha does.
When in school, I was terrible at algebra, the same as Sasha is. And so I actually thought to myself, what if I did that? What if I actually substituted the X and the Y for food? Could that actually, no, wouldn't work, because then it would just confuse me. But I felt Sasha's pain in that episode, I really did.
Me too, I hate math.
I hate math too. I don't like math. I don't like to adult with math. Math is cool.
You nerd.
Learning is a good thing.
I think learning is a great thing. You're absolutely right. Stay in school. Don't do drugs. I think we're done there.
Questions. You want to take questions?
There's a microphone.
I don't know why it's aiming toward.
We had a little warm up. We had some lovely con staff that are maybe still here. But thank you, con staff.
Oh, yeah.
There you are. Thank you so much. That was awesome. Super great. Super great. Something about pizza. There was a promise of pizza?
Somebody say cake?
Squirrel.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
First off, thank you for coming to our humble.
Oh,
Ashley. Oh, yeah. That's
good to be. Ashley is kind of opposite. I think I asked everyone this yesterday. We're long
That's
down.
Totally fine.
So just
I'm just judging you.
I was just wondering, like, what are some of the, not necessarily even anime, just animation in general that you guys used to watch when you were younger or still watch today that you really enjoy?
Oh, that's a really good question.
Mm-hmm. I'll actually, I don't know if they gave you actual shows yesterday, so I'm going to do that.
Oh, okay, cool.
Well, right now I watch Steven Universe and Adventure Time. If you haven't seen Over the Garden Wall is incredible. When I was a kid, I basically watched anything that was on Cartoon Network. So Dexter's Lab, Powerpuff Girls, and Samurai Jack. Basically. Is Samurai Jack coming back? Hooray!
Like if you were like, I've always been a huge fan of cartoons. I grew up in a single parent household. My mom's amazing, and she would take the four kids to like the Disney movie, because back in the day, there was only like one major cartoon that was released in theaters every year, and that was the Disney movie, right? And so like we would all look forward to it, and it was really exciting. So I'm not a Disney princess because I don't really feel like that's a good thing to continue to push out onto people. Although, if you want to be a princess, rock it. I've always loved cartoons. I still love cartoons. It's great that like my friends have kids now because, I mean, everyone's like, oh, we're going to go see Star Wars. And I'm like, who wants to go see The Good Dinosaur with me? So I can take my friend's kids and I'm like, hey, guys, listen. I pick and choose, and I'm like, all right, Good Dinosaur, and my friend Oz, her son Cooper, is like, oh yeah, we'll go see The Good Dinosaur, and I spoke with him about it recently. I was like, do you still want to go see The Good Dinosaur? He's like, don't you want to go to a Mavs game? I'm like, well, you're ruined. So, I love cartoons.
Earth Convinced is my favorite Disney princess.
There was this one time I went to a park, that's not appropriate. It was a funny story about Dirk and everything, but that doesn't matter. What we're talking about is cartoons, and I love cartoons. I'm a big fan of like adult cartoons, so like Family Guy is a huge one for me. I love Family Guy. Bob's Burgers is my jam. Like on bad days, like I'll come home and my boyfriend will be like, is everything okay? I'm like, I just need a little Bob's Burger. He's like, maybe a cheeseburger. I'm like, maybe. So Bob's Burgers is a big one for me. Adventure Time is awesome. Super great. The writers on that show are brilliant. I love cartoons. All cartoons, especially cartoons. Oh my god, Inside Out?
Inside Out!
So good!
So good! So good.
I have all the feels.
I started to tear up around the movie, but when she comes back home in the lot, like towards the end, that's when I really started to be like, oh, because moving when you're a kid sucks.
Oh, it's terrible.
Yep. Because you have to make new friends, and making friends is awesome, don't get me wrong. But, you know, it's a strange place, and it's like, it's terrible.
It's terrible. It's kind of traumatic. Like, yeah. I moved between second and third grade, that's the source of all my problems.
He's still going to therapy now.
Yeah. No, we've got a better house.
There are so many cartoons that I love. I'm a kid at heart, total kid at heart, so I love me some Gargoyles, love me some Family Guy, love me some Doug. Anybody remember Doug?
Doug, yeah.
Which is on Hulu now. I marathoned the whole thing in like 2 days. Thank you very much. Let's see, what else? What am I? Yes.
Do you remember Animal Monsters?
Yeah! Rugrats, but the earlier Rugrats, not after Dill, because that's when it started to go downhill a little bit for me. I'm trying to think of what else. David the Gnome. American Dad. I think American Dad's hilarious, and I also like Family Guy. Have not gotten into Bob's Burgers yet.
It's what? Really
good. I know it's terrible, but I do know the
Tina.
I know that. But I don't know anything else. Let's see what else. This could go on and on.
Ooh,
and on.
Archer.
Yes, Archer. Yeah.
Did you watch Rick and Morty? Do you like adult cartoons? Do you watch Rick and Morty?
No, you and Rita told me about Rick
and Morty. Dude, you should watch Rick and Morty.
Have you seen the guy, the voice of Archer in Aziz Ansari's new show?
Matt John H. John Benjamin.
H. John Benjamin. Yeah, he's great in it.
I'm also a huge Disney nerd. Like, I love me some Disney. I would take Tangled over Frozen any day. Anyway, moving on.
Being the fourth in line with all those cartoons mentioned, there's not really. I dig a ton of those. I was big into Disney too. I watched some old stuff too, like old Speed Racer stuff.
Yeah.
I've flirted with Bob's Burgers. I haven't really gotten into it yet.
We're not friends
anymore. I love Archer. I love Archer. I just love how irreverent that thing could be like a podcast. It's just, it's awesome. And I'm currently watching BoJack Horseman.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
I've heard it's really good.
You guys are all awesome. Thank you.
You're awesome. Thank you.
For all of you.
Cool.
What's your favorite scene in the whole show?
Favorite scene in the whole show. David, do you know?
The one that I'm... No, I'm scared. I always go back to the very first episode. I mean, it may not be my favorite scene exactly, but it's the one that I feel like sticks in my brain a lot when Aaron has to, you know, watch his mom just get ripped from him, you know what I mean? I just feel like that's the trajectory, that's the beginning, that launches everything.
You're dark as fuck, man. You're dark as fuck, man.
Yeah, I'm dark. People love me because I'm dark. I'm just kidding. That's what comes to mind. Let me keep thinking, though.
There's too many to choose from.
Yeah.
Before I forget, little disclaimer, I totally forget to talk about this every time that I do this panel. Trina and I have done this panel many times together, and David and I have done it a couple times. Ash and I have never done it before. We usually want to avoid manga spoilers.
Oh, yeah.
Because a lot of us and a lot of you have not read the manga yet, so we do want to avoid those spoilers, but we are totally open to talk about everything that has been shown in the anime. We cool?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. Sounds good.
Shh. And pay attention. favorite scene. Oh gosh. There's a lot. I love any scenes where Jean and Aaron are yelling at each other. I think that's really entertaining. I love any scenes with Sasha and Connie. I think they are hilarious.
Love Connie.
Connie and Sasha are like just, you guys are a perfect duo, man. You are the only comic relief in that entire show.
I know. Sasha, yeah. I said earlier that all she does is, I'm actually really happy that all she does is eat, and that's her only focus, because otherwise that show would just be nonstop Hummertown. You need to get broken up by something.
One of my favorite scenes is when Annie beats Rhina and Aaron and they're training. I think that's one of my favorite scenes because it's hilarious to me. A girl beats two boys. Yay! Girl power!
Yeah, it is.
It's really hard to choose.
There's a lot of really good scenes. I think one of my favorite scenes is in the beginning when they're training, and Sasha's like eating a potato, and he walks up and he's like, "What's that in your hand?" And she's like, "A potato, sir." And she's like, "Bah, bah, bah." And she's like, "Oh, it's a potato." And he's like,
"Why would you eat that?"
Running to their back. And just like, I think that was awesome.
Oh, I love when Krista brings you water, and you're like, "You must be a goddess, Gloria to you!"
Oh, yeah, that's a great scene. That's probably my favorite like comedy scene that I got to do. I guess outside of Sasha scenes, there's the Armin speech, right?
Mm.
Yeah.
Episode 10, yeah.
Which maybe I just love so much because I love hearing Josh talk about it.
You're about to get in trouble.
Josh, talk about
his speech, and like, because he has such a connection to Armin, and it's so sweet, and like, he just loves the show so much. So I've done a couple of panels with him, and hearing him talk about it is like always really cool.
Give us a summation, because I'm not sure what he says about him.
Oh, I remember him saying that he relates to Armin a lot, and like, his arc as a character, and I don't know, he's just very, I don't know. Just talk about how much better Josh is at these panels than I am. he's just really passionate about the show, and he like really cares about Armin as a character. And I think that speech is kind of the culmination of like Armin's arc, I think.
I think he talks about too, like Armin's arc of coming into his own, you know, not having confidence, not having a bit of an inferiority complex, and not recognizing his own, you know, contribution and worth, and then at some point, you know, finding that, oh, my friend talked about this the other day, yesterday, that, oh, my friends trust me, and they think I'm valuable, and they think I have something to offer, and oh, wait, maybe I do, and I really relate to that arc. I dig that a lot. I think it's cool to watch him sort of simpering and scared and feel like he messed everything up, and then, you know, come out of that. Yeah, definitely brave. Yeah, yeah. For sure.
It's an incredible scene because it really is a huge, as you said, Ash, it's like a huge character growth for him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and especially since up until that point, we've seen Armin. I mean, he holds his own and he gets through training and everything. He may not be physically strong, but he's incredibly intelligent, and they really need that, especially to survive. And he doesn't think that he's worth anything because he can't actually, you know, keep up with everybody with the fight. But, you know, in that scene, you know, Aaron basically says, "No, we need you." And in that moment, it's something just goes on in his head, and
I love the sort of the juxtaposition of like Mikasa and Aaron and Armin, because, you know, Mikasa's this badass warrior. She can kick all their asses. Naturally talented and just has it. It's like being in the zone. It's like Michael Jordan. So, you know, a great athlete who just has that. And then you've got Aaron, who is the passion is just, and the anger and the need to act. And he acts before he thinks. And then you've got Armin, who his strength is strategy and thinking and you know, how do we best approach this? And I love that. I just love the combination of that. Yeah.
I think it's really interesting what Attack on Titan does as far as gender roles, which Ashley and I have spoken on this several times, but the idea that if you're a male, right, you have to be tough, and you have to be whatever, and the creators of Attack on Titan chose to have the toughest, most agile fighter out of the three main people be a female,
right?
And so she's a female, and she's not emotional, and she's very like driven, but she's also, because frequently, like if you're a girl in this genre, in anime and such, you can be a good fighter, but you also have to be really... and she's not hypersexualized, and she's not wearing like armor that's strategically placed.
Right. Yeah,
and so I think that's really neat. But similarly, for the male characters like Armin, it's okay to cry. Like he cries a lot. He's sensitive, and that's okay. I think it's really neat to have that being shown in this genre or any.
All the characters they're multifaceted and complex, you know, which you don't always find not only in anime but in any entertainment. So I mean, you just don't find that much. I mean, even, you know, I think it's interesting that Bertolt is, I think, fourth in his class, third in the class, or fourth maybe, and very skilled, and just doesn't have, but that's juxtaposed against, he doesn't have leadership skills, he doesn't really have a drive, he wants to stay comfortable, and that's kind of a flaw, you know? It's fun to play those type of roles, and I think that's why everything in this show is, one of the reasons it's so popular is there's all of that in it, you know? There's something, everybody can find something about themselves in the show.
I don't know if you noticed, but we really like this show.
Yeah. It's an awesome show. So it's an awesome show, and I honestly, I that's one of my favorite scenes that I mentioned. But there's just so many good scenes, and I'm watching it through again right now because I want to remember every frame, and I want to be able to actually go through every frame, which I haven't been able to do in a while. And I, instead of like, you know, just paying attention to what my character does. This show has so many amazing characters, and I am actually finding myself respecting a lot. Mikasa especially. and you know, just all the female characters in this show are amazing, and all the male characters, like, and not to mention it's just such a good cast. Like, everybody in the show is amazing. No, I'm saying, apart from this table, obviously, but like, you know, just everybody in the show truly, really is fascinated, and they love this show. And anyway, that's it.
I feel like all we do at these panels is like, let's talk about how amazing we are. Because we are amazing.
I just love you guys.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Hello.
Show that, like, what, like, means the most to you in the show? Like, that really touches you.
What really touches?
Touches. I think Trina kind of touched on it earlier, but I think it's a really interesting show because, like, I like a lot of anime, to be honest. I mean, I watched anime as a kid, I forgot to mention this earlier, but, like, Sailor Moon was, like, my favorite show. It basically taught me to become a feminist when I was a little girl. But a lot of anime is really problematic. I think we can, even as people that love anime, I think we can say that there's like a lot of not awesome representations of women in anime. There's not a lot of not awesome representations of men. And Attack on Titan is, I think, a really important show because not only is it so popular, I think it's like one of the few shows that has really permeated American culture in a while too, and in like a broad sense. But it also, it doesn't play into gender norms very often. I was actually thinking when you were talking, often in, if there's ever like a group of characters that are mixed gendered, the woman is almost never comedic relief. Like she's always usually like the voice of reason or whatever that happens to be. And so Sasha being the comedic relief character, I think is actually really awesome and actually kind of important because women often don't get to play roles like that.
Because women aren't funny.
No. Never.
What are you thinking?
No, but yeah, I think the thing that I love about Attack on Titan, apart from the fact that it's just a great show and that the fan base is so awesome and dedicated, is that, yeah, I think it does really cool stuff with its characters and it does unexpected things, especially with gender norms, and I think that's really important.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. The thing that touches me most about this show, sorry, I think it's excuse me if you've heard this before, because it's kind of a spiel of mine, but I think what's really neat about Attack on Titan is that, again, I apologize if you've heard this, Lauren's heard it several times, it's an idea that there are forces, right? Giant, horrible, horrific, scary forces, and they're everywhere in your life, right? And you're constantly defending yourself against them. Like, we don't have to worry about a giant, you know, genitalless, naked monster ripping off the roof and reaching in and being like, hey, Lauren, you have the popcorn.
Yet.
Right. But everybody has a titan, right? Everybody has a titan that they face every day. Maybe that's a bully. Maybe that's problems at home, or war, or disease, or an eating disorder, body dysmorphia, illness. Everyone has something, right? And it seems insurmountable, and it seems giant, and it seems scary, and it's it's something that is hard to face. But with Attack on Titan, you know, you see these kids basically going out and they're facing these titans and taking them on. And I think that that's kind of why Attack on Titan has had such a broad audience, is because it's a basic human truth, right? That there are scary things just outside of your world and constantly threatening you, and you face them. And I think that that's what's most important to me about Attack on Titan. And it's what really touches my heart in the feels. I think it's cool that people can view art and be inspired by it. So as long as that doesn't happen and nobody shifts over there, I think we'll be fine.
That was really lovely.
Good for now.
What?
Good job. Katrina, you're great. I like
that you went into like bitch mode.
What?
I don't know. Like, there's so many things that you know touches me throughout this show. Like, I don't know. I think it's just such a beautiful show. I think it's also very tragic, but there are so many beautiful things about it. Like, even through the darkest times, you can still find light, where if you have good comrades and good friends, and especially when it's, you know, fight or flight, you know what I mean? It's you have to focus on surviving, but you're there with other people. You're not necessarily alone doing that. And I think that's probably one of the things that reaches out to me the most, is that all of the characters, for the most part, all basically become family to each other because they don't have anybody else. And I think that's one of the best parts, honestly, about it. Obviously everything so far that Trina and Ash have said as well, I totally agree with. But I think that's also another aspect of it, is just when you're alone, you don't want to be alone most of the time, and it's always nice to actually have someone there with you to fight through one of your titans. So, yeah.
I mean, I can echo everything that everyone has said. I think what Trina said is really important. I mean, that's the one thing that we all have in common, is that we all have things that are daunting to us, that are scary, that feel insurmountable, that we don't know how to get over. What I think is interesting is about Attack on Titan is, and it's sort of a study of humanity and how is how we respond to that. And I think Attack on Titan shows many different ways in which to respond to adversity, to threat. And the things that stick out to me are phrases like, you know, the gray area, or which we talked a little bit about, I talked about on a panel yesterday. And truth, what is the actual truth? And then our human need to try to control the titan or the adversity, to try to manage it and figure out how to control it and bottle it and keep ourselves safe from it. And so what's great about Titan is you see all of these different factions. You know, everybody has the same goal, ostensibly, right? That's, we want to survive, and humanity wants to survive. But everybody has different ideas throughout on how we need to survive, or what the best strategy is to that. And so you end up not knowing exactly, you know, what the real truth is, and you know, what the answer is. There's no great answer or the best answer. And I think in many ways, when you are fighting your titan or whatever, it's a trial and error type of thing. Unfortunately, life is like a try it and see if it works sort of game. And that can suck, because you can't figure it out before you do it, you know? And so I think you get to see all of these different people, and that what creates conflict between them is that, no, we should do this, no, we should do this, or I'm going to do this, but you know what, I'm not going to tell anybody about it right now. I'm just going to do it, because I think it's better. And it's what we do in life, and it's what we do. So that really speaks to me, because it's just like, what's real, you know? What is the truth here? Who really has the right choice or the best choice? And I think that that's another reason why it's attractive to people, because even if we can't necessarily articulate it, that's what we do on a daily basis.
That's a good point. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
So,
the mic.
There you go. Okay, so, I've got. Why exactly is pizza always so sad without Aaron?
Ooh. Why is Mikasa so sad without Aaron? For her character in particular, when you see her character development and where she came from, and I'm sorry if this is a spoiler, earmuffs. So having witnessed her, both of her parents be murdered, and then she's taken into, basically a slavery, and is going to be sold for what's implied to be something pretty horrible. And having her innocence taken so quickly and being pulled from like this really happy place where she's just knitting with her ma to like, oh, they're dead and now I'm going into, I'm going into human trafficking and I'm going to be a slave. to have that shift so dramatically and then to be saved by Aaron and him basically give her the truth, as he knows it, which is if you're going to live, you have to fight. And her make that shift so quickly and so ferociously that she stabs a grown man through his back at like seven. I think that is as a character to have that kind of shift and have him be kind of my brother in that journey. I think that there's a really strong bond between those two characters that isn't necessarily romantic, but is really deep. And so I think that Mikasa in general isn't necessarily sad without Aaron, but I think that she's very devoted to him in that, he helped he did save her life, and he helped shape her as a person.
Oh. Yeah. Okay, also,
Armin is very susceptible to colds, and without the futon over his head, he catches a very bad cold. Like, seriously, without the futon over his head, he starts sneezing. In the dodgeball episode, which is actually a very good follow-up question, because in that same episode, I almost called her Trina. Mikasa, again, this is a comedic show, so they kind of go overboard with a bunch of things, but, Mikasa gets super, just very sad, and she covers herself with Armin's futon, and Jean even says, Armin, where's your futon? And then sees, like, Mikasa, and she's all like, the world is a dark place. I'm sorry, do it. The world is a dark place. The world is a dark place. And it's like super depressing. And then Armin just starts sneezing. So now Armin needs his security futon because otherwise he'll get really sick. And well, hopefully not die.
Right through that. Also, thanks to Levi for fixing it.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi.
Hello. Very nice cosplay. You look adorable.
Thank you. I have only one question. So if you could say what the core feeling attribute of your character was, what would it be?
Ooh, man. Core feeling or attribute?
Hunger.
Nice.
Feeling and
devotion. For Annie, I would probably... You would think that either would be anger or just no emotion, but I actually think it's pain. I think it's pain because she's clearly not happy doing what she ends up doing, as you can see in the last episode, because she's crying, and she clearly has painful memories of her father. So I definitely think it's pain.
I don't know if these words make sense at all in succession together, but silent, invisible survival.
I thought it would be kindness because he's so sweet.
Aww. Yeah, I think I think he's sweet. I do. I think he's really kind. But I think there is an intense need to not be seen as well.
Mm.
That I don't know where that stems from exactly, but I think that's why he's not a proven leader, why he's not driven in those ways. I think he says, you know, I joined because I just wanna go guard the king and chill out. You know?
Thanks.
Yeah,
awesome.
That's a great question.
You guys are awesome.
Thank you. Hello.
Hi. If you had any type of superpower, what would it be?
Besides everything.
Like, you would rule the world. Like, oh yeah, invisibility, got that. Fire, no problem. Like, flying, duh.
Like, if you did everything.
What would your name be if you do everything, man?
Just asshole. Just super dick.
Because you could be.
There's no way that person isn't a total asshole.
Right?
There's just no way.
Oh my god, yesterday I ran into everything, man. That guy is a dick.
He just spun around in a circle like throwing fireballs. There's a
you can just do everything.
You can do. Why was he a dick? What did he do? Everything. Jeez. What was so bad about it?
Everything, man.
I would probably have telekinesis or flying.
Yeah.
Cool.
I would want, I don't know if it's a superpower, but I would want to be able to play any instrument in the world. That would be my ability, not power, but ability. And to control the weather.
mine is kind of like a Star Wars thing. Like some type of power to be able to control or manipulate with my mind. Yeah, with thinking. Mostly for myself to manage my own crazy thoughts. Some type of the ability to move or influence with mind control.
I think I'd want to have ultimate healing powers like Wolverine, but not with the rage or like the things. I don't really want to do that. I have to get my nails done once a week anyways. Like, I don't know what kind of maintenance those things require. So cool healing properties where I could also heal other people.
Oh, that's a good one.
Yeah. And then if my friends died, I'd be like, no, Ashley. You're fine. Everything's cool. That'd be great, right? And if I had ultimate healing and stuff like that, everlasting life, I could also eat whatever I wanted.
That's a good power. I changed mine to that power.
You'd never be full, uncomfortable. Full.
Yeah.
You'd just be I could eat. It's not insatiable hunger, but I could eat.
I love that.
And anything you
I
can
want
have
that. I changed my answer.
So you can just eat donuts.
Right.
And they would be eating a broccoli, a thing of broccoli.
Totally.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. You wouldn't have to suffer from food babies.
Yeah, you could go eat tacos and you could be like, hey, can you get some pizza? Yeah, that's my superpower.
How about a burger in 30 minutes? Yeah.
That's good. Get some tops? Split some tops?
That sushi looks really good. You want that?
Yeah. My friend Ricky said that was where the tater tots are. I don't know why that's super important.
I'm sorry.
And also, is mayonnaise an instrument?
Is mayonnaise an instrument?
I think if you splat it on things,
yeah,
you can make mayonnaise fashion.
Yeah.
Mayonnaise could be an instrument. It's instrumental to sandwiches.
It definitely is instrumental.
You made this world, Trina.
Sandwiches and mayonnaise! I don't know why I get that.
Thank you.
Thank you for your question.
Hello.
Hello.
You were the Armin yesterday.
I was the Armin yesterday.
You were an awesome Armin.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, you're a much better. I can talk. Anyway, so for the question, I want to shout out to Ashley because you're in Steins Gate, and Steins Gate is our favorite anime, and I'm really glad I got to see you.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yay. Thank you.
Yay. That's awesome.
I love Steins Gate.
Steins Gate means more love. And my actual question is, if you could switch places with any of the characters you played or live in any of the universes, which character or universe would you pick?
Oh.
Do you have to, like, follow their storyline, or could you just live in the universe?
Whichever.
Okay.
Okay. This is a hard question. Let me think. And I'm have to, like, remember all the characters that I played.
I would say, well... Okay, I too am in Steins Gate, and if I...
You're in Steins Gate.
I'm Makise.
What?
What?
I did not know that.
Really?
Yeah.
Shut up.
Aww.
Did you finish that?
That's not important.
You did it. Oh my god, I'm really excited about it. It was really, really hard. There was so much crying.
You're so good at that show.
You're great. No, you're great. I would want to live in the Steins Gate universe, but I wouldn't want to follow their arc because it's kind of messed up. But as long as I could like time travel, that'd be pretty cool. And if I could be Makise because she's like a genius child.
Yeah.
Like she has her PhD and been in time travel. Like that would be dope. I would do it totally different. Like I would live her life differently. I'd be like, oh yes, I'm a genius and I invented time travel and now I'm going to invent a way that I can eat anything at any time.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks.
I'm
shaking. Oh!
Don't
out of excitement.
Yeah.
You don't need to shake, man. We all poop up here.
Yeah.
You poop.
True.
We poop.
Yeah.
We all
poop. Yeah.
Just normal people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's not a little bad.
I smell that, by the way. I will tell people that. I'll think of you every time I say it.
Oh, okay. Nice! Let's give it up for
the
poop!
I have to
show you this. I feel like there's a good answer to this and I can't. I'm literally looking at it.
Yeah, Google.
No.
Usually it's not polite to Google yourself in public, but Google yourself. I tell people they can't Google me until they buy me a drink.
Well, we're all thinking, what I just showed Trina and David is actually a picture that Jessica Camello sent me, and she is the voice of Hanji, and she is holding a baby that is in a colossal titan costume. Like,
onesie.
It's a onesie, I'm sorry, it's a onesie, and it is a, like, probably an 8-month-old baby. And it is absolutely ridiculous, so it's hilarious. And it's perfect timing because we're on a Titan panel, so. Okay, if we could be any of our other characters, or if we could switch characters. Let's see.
I have mine now, if you need to think more.
You bet.
I have mine now, if you need
to
think
okay.
more.
Oh, okay, yes, I need to think
more. So I'm a character, a small character in Saints Row. And I would be in Saints Row because you get to have superpowers in Saints Row. So.
What would your superpower be?
You get all of them in Saints Row. Honestly.
So you're
I'd be the master.
Like, oh, Trina, I'm just like, that's amazing. Thanks. That's great. Good for you, Ashley. Good for you.
I would probably, and this is just because Sailor Moon was also one of my favorite shows, and in Sailor Moon, so I'm very
Who
excited.
Who are you in Sailor Moon?
Sailor Neptune!
That's so sick!
Oh my god, that's really dope. I got really excited, I know.
I thought I told you this!
No, I had no idea.
I'm a horrible person.
You're not, I'm so excited now.
I would, oh sorry, Trina. No, all the energy just going back and forth. Like a little, I need my futon.
Security futon. Yeah, she was always one of my favorite characters anyway, so I love that she is incredibly graceful and beautiful, and she plays the violin, and she's an artist, and she's very inspirational, so yeah. And she has a hot girlfriend, there you go, so.
Yeah!
I'm so jealous.
Yeah.
I want to be a Sailor Scout.
Mine is harkening back to the first anime I ever did, like 9,000 years ago, but it would be, I would want to be Orphan in orphan. It's kind of similar to what my superpower, he's a sorcerer and yeah, just has a great attributes of character that I would, you know, love to be able to embody on a daily basis. So yeah, that's probably the character I would want to be in the same universe I want to live in, so yeah.
That's a good question, thanks.
Thank you.
Not that any of the other ones
weren't,
they're all good questions.
So cute.
Collecting you all.
Oh, you're cute too.
Hello.
My question is, do you ever see yourself in the characters you voice as or play as, I should say?
In Attack on Titan or anything?
Yes, for me. I always try to find something that is similar in a character that I play to myself, or something that I can really relate to that's not hard for me to understand. And then there are the things that maybe I can't relate to or I don't understand their actions. And bringing those two things closer together to where I really have to try to understand why they do what they do or think what they think or say what they say. So definitely, I mean, it's, you know, I don't know, this is getting all actory or whatever, but, you know, our job is to tell someone's story, right? Not only their individual human story, but also how they fit into that story of that world. So, yeah, definitely so. And there are some more so than not. There are also cases where I've played some kind of crazy characters where I've, you know, they're not like me at all, and they would do some crazy things that I would never do. And those are the ones I typically leave the booth and just forget about, you know what I mean? Or I don't remember, I don't have as strong an attachment that stays with me. But there are a lot of, you know, a handful of characters that I not only put myself into, but I think their attributes are part of who I am. So, yeah, definitely so.
Yeah, I also try and find, you know, aspects of my characters that I can also relate to. What's going on over here?
I'm sorry.
I start laughing when other people start laughing, so I'm like, I need to know what's going on. It's real good. Brain fart. Aspects, yes. Specifically for Annie, I think what I can relate to her is that I don't get angry often, but when I do, I find that that's what my voice sounds like. Annie's voice is what my voice sounds like when I'm super, super angry. And I try to stay away from that because I try to be really positive and I try to feel positive emotions, but we're human beings. Anger is a part of life. And I finally, you know, a bunch of people have asked me, where did you find that voice? That's where I found it. When I'm really, really mad, that's what I sound like. And it didn't occur to me until I think about a year ago. So
what David said, I like to put myself into the characters.
I think
I mean technically I mean done it.
It's funny because I feel like the popular view of actors is that we're all crazy, which is not inaccurate necessarily, but like basically there's like the bad stereotype of an actor, right? Which is like the prima donna, doesn't care about anyone else, whatever. But I think honestly, to me, the heart of good acting is empathy. So there's always a connection that I think we have to the characters, whether or not we literally relate to them and can put some of our emotions and our psychosis into them. We either do that or I think we empathize with what they're going through. So I feel like any character that you really care about, I mean, there are bit parts like that, you know, I like go into a military game and I scream for 2 hours and I'm like, well, I'm really connected with the feeling of war. That's not what I'm doing. I'm just screaming for 2 hours. But there are like lots of characters, like my character in Life is Strange, Chloe, I have like a very deep emotional connection to. I think at least for me, like my favorite performances that I have are characters that I empathize with very deeply. So.
I think that's the word empathy is huge. You have to, and acceptance. So our job is not to judge the character, it's to empathize and figure out why they do what they do. I think that's, yeah, I love that. You have to be an empath to be a good actor, I think.
Thank you. Also,
Quick question, do you ship Levi X Windex?
That's the first. I have done a Titan panel a lot, many times. Trina, you've also done this many times. Have you ever heard that before? I haven't either. That's a new one. What was it again? What was the pairing?
Levi and Windex.
As in the window cleaner, right?
What's your answer?
Yes, now I see it.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. So we have about 10 minutes left, you guys. We're going to do one question per person because a lot of people ask too much, which is totally fine, but we want to try and get everybody.
Let's
so
get it.
Go ahead, sir.
Come with it. I don't know what that was.
As much as before,
yes.
So, without giving away anything, what have you learned or are learning from playing as Lychee Fei Ling?
Lychee Fei Ling?
Sorry.
Well, I've been playing her for almost 6 years, so I would hope that it wouldn't be a spoiler. She's a very, very giving and very genuine, loving person, and she's also a very sensual person, which is a lot of fun to play. And she is, when she has somebody in her life that she cares about, she really will protect them, and that's pretty much all that I've learned about her. She's a great character. I love her. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
Hey.
Hey, girl. Hey.
So, I just want to say, especially to Ashley, really quickly, that you said about the prima donna vibe. I've never gotten that from any voice actor ever.
That's good.
So,
for all of you.
Nice. And then, for my question, I touched on this with David yesterday, but I'm curious what everyone else's opinion is. Who do you think is the real enemy in Attack on Titan?
I happen to know David's answer, which I can totally agree with, which is, honestly don't know, because in this universe, everybody is fighting for something and they think that they might be doing the right thing, but we don't know. We don't know what their motive is. So I honestly do not know. I don't know who the bad guys are because we don't know where the Titans come from. So they could just be, I have no idea. That's what I love about this show, is that there are so many unanswered questions. Like, I still want to know what's in the stupid cellar. I still want to know!
I think everyone does.
Yeah.
I agree.
Me too. Sorry, let's come out.
And you know, unless we're talking about, like, pure evil, there are those cases, but in this show, everybody who has, that you could perceive as bad, or I think they all think that they're doing good. And so it becomes really complicated, you know? There's not pure evil in this show. Everybody thinks that what they're doing, whatever that is the right choice. And so it becomes really like that gray area where, which is fascinating. Like, I can't wait to see how this goes.
Yeah.
I feel like that makes the Titan characters, like Annie, so complex because, like, even though they're still friends with everybody,
mm-hmm.
you know, like, they're also sort of the enemy. And so right. She's kind of like, where is your true line?
That's actually a very good way to put it, because a lot of people ask me, like, how do you feel about Annie being the villain? And I do not see her as a villain. I see her as the enemy, as the enemy to the main characters, but that doesn't mean that she's a villain. I think that, because all that we know about Annie is that obviously she was trained from a very young age for some sort of mission. We don't know exactly what the mission was. It most likely had something to do with Eren, but we don't know her purpose. We don't know, we just know that she was trained to do this from a young age, and she clearly probably didn't have much of a childhood, and she was probably just programmed pretty much to just finish this mission no matter what it took. And because I don't know her past,
because none of us, I don't think, know her past, I wouldn't call her a villain. Because I love playing villains, and I will always say, oh yeah, totally a villain. But I never have gotten that vibe that she is a villain. I just think that she is a part of a mission that we don't know about, and obviously she is an enemy, but not evil, I don't think. She's done some pretty bad things, the evil things, but I don't think she's evil.
It's also like, sorry, I promise I will not believe it 20 more, but it's like the word enemy is relative, right? It's all relative. So if I'm aligned with someone who is known as an enemy, they are not an enemy to me. If I'm aligned with them, they're not an enemy.
Y'all sound like a bunch of Titan apologists to me.
Well, our characters are like our babies. I know everybody says that, but it's true.
It's hard to pick.
It's very hard to pick because I like to imagine if I picked a least favorite character, they would show up in my hotel room and kill me slowly. So I don't really, you know, not really, but I don't know, guys.
Well, that's an excellent question that I have the answer to. The answer is that it changes all the time, so no one who has their feelings hurt shows up and murders us. My favorite character at this very moment would be SacAnime from Attack on Titan. Somebody's like, woo! my least favorite character would have to be Girl C. From whatever show that I was Girl C in.
That is a brilliant answer.
Sometimes you just do like little bit parts and they're just like one-offs. So it's like a girl in a classroom. It's like, I'm ready to go, guys! And that's it. So like Girl C, like she didn't really contribute anything.
I mean, for me personally, it was Girl F. But
yeah, Girl F, man.
That is actually a really good response because it does change all the time, just depending on, you know. Probably like most recently, I was in the game Life is Strange as Chloe, and that's just a very recent experience and also like a very emotional experience, and I put a lot of myself into that character, so right now she's just right here. It's raw. It's raw. But yeah, probably just the ones you forget about. Like, there are bit parts that I've done, like Walla, or like just small things like we need this character filled out. There's another character in Life is Strange that's like having sex with someone behind a door. That she's, I don't know.
I played one of those too.
Did you?
Yeah.
It's really awkward.
It was really awkward.
My director was a guy, and he's wonderful. His name's Phil, and he was like, I'm just gonna let you go, and I'm gonna hide. He was like, put his head down.
I was in the Walla session with Zach, and he's like, so who has an Australian accent? Who wants to be? Is there anyone in this room that can do an Australian grandmother having sex in the next room? I was like, I can't.
Wait, a grandmother too? That's actually awesome. That should be your favorite character. Fuck me, Lisa. My grandma's hardcore.
Yeah, it was like super S&M and like bondage. It doesn't matter.
I agree with that answer as well. You know, and a lot of the times, the character that I'm doing at that moment, aside from, you know, Man F or Teacher 1 or whatever, you know, is my favorite character at that time. I would have to throw out Briareos and Appleseed is one of my favorite characters to play. I just have a connection to that character. And then, yeah, I don't really have characters that are my least favorite, except, you know, bit parts are more of a technical job. You go
yeah,
in, you gotta, yeah, you got a thing to do and you do it, you're screaming or you're whatever. Those are the ones you just don't remember at all. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's
thank
a great
you.
Question.
Hello.
You
look amazing.
Yeah, you do.
Yeah.
Okay, so you've seen all the terrible things that your characters go through in the Attack on Titan world. Would you choose the same regimen as your character chooses, or would you choose something else? Or
as
like
us?
Yeah, as yourself.
Oh, I wouldn't.
I would be damned for Michael more go.
Yeah.
I would be the first person that gets crushed by the Titan when they break the wall. Like, right. Instantly.
There's no way.
Yeah.
Whichever regiment, like, guards the food, I want to be in there. I don't want to be the person that's, like, out there doing the... I don't want to guard, like, rich people. I just want to guard some food, like, hang out, eat, pick it. I would not be good at that. I would die quickly.
Yeah.
A horrible death.
Yeah. I'm not very skilled when it comes to that, so I would probably do something along those lines. If I had to choose between the regiments, I'd probably choose the MP, because the garrisons still have to do stuff. And then the scout regiment, obviously, they have to actually go out and do stuff.
They're dead.
And they're dead. And the MPs, they have to do a lot. So, I got MPs.
Yeah, I would like to say that if I was in that situation, I would choose like the garrison, like guard the wall, you know, thinking that I could still, you know, be a badass and carry a gun and maybe like, you know, rough some people up, but not really have to die or do anything. I would be somewhere in between that. I'd be like, I'd probably choose garrison, but be the guy who's like the last person that you get to at the wall. Like, I'm just gonna, you know.
I'm just gonna hang out here, guys.
Yeah.
Is there like a medic position in any of these? I guess it'd be a medic or something.
Cool.
Yeah, that's smart.
Yeah.
But then you have to deal with like blood and like amputation.
That's true.
You remember that
one? I love those things.
He just got it. His mom was like, "Where's my son? Where's my son?" And they're like, "Here's his arm."
So, yeah.
First episode. That's not.
It's the first episode.
Some people really can't handle the intensity of this show, and I totally understand that. But when I saw this show, I was hooked off of the first episode. I was just like, oh, this is going to be so good. But anyway, so yeah.
Thank you for your question.
Thank you.
We still have time? Or is this it? It's done. We're all done.
Oh, they're giving us the waves, so we got to finish this. Yeah,
stop. Are you all going to be the same autograph session as me? Am I going to
be autographing things in the autograph room, which is
in the
artists
are
Allie. So
thank you for coming.
Yes, thank you for coming. Thank you for coming. So much time. Thank you guys. Thank you for coming. So let's get out of here. Yes.
All right, thanks for coming to the Tap on Time panel, everyone.